So over the past year, we've had some awesome releases in 3D, and I'm going to cover some of these great features that you can do today in ArcGIS Online. So the first thing I want to show you is our support for vector tile layers in 3D. Here in the scene viewer, I have a vector tile layer draped over the Esri world elevation layer. The performance is great, and you can use your own custom vector tile styles. The next thing I want to show you is our support for smart mapping in 3D. So here, I have a local scene with some recorded earthquakes from the North Ridge event. Going into the layer, I can choose the recorded magnitude for all these earthquakes. And we can see that my scene is updating in real time. But I want to go in and further customize this layer. So going underneath the options, I'm going to change my symbol to spheres. And I'm going to use the magnitude to also drive the size. And we're seeing this all updating instantly. And I can use the slider to better see where all those really the strongest earthquakes have taken place. Now I want to talk about how you can actually create 3D optimized scene layers in ArcGIS Online. So here I have a data set of some New York City trees, and there's over 75,000 features. I can go over to the Overview tab on the Item Detail page and click on the Publish button and begin publishing a point scene layer from this point feature layer. Once the publishing process has completed, I can bring it into a new web scene. Here I have a web scene already started with some 3D objects with some New York City buildings coming from a 3D object scene layer. I generated these buildings from a multi-patch feature layer in ArcGIS Online, doing that exact same workflow with the trees. I also have a tree layer already added into this web scene, but it's showing up as cylinders. And I want to talk to you about the new 3D web styles that we have. So I'm going to go in and configure this layer. I'm selecting the 3D option. And when I click on the symbol, I can open up the library of the Esri 3D web styles, from realistic street signs down to thematic trees. I'm just going to select one of the trees, and I'm going to use the recorded tree height to drive the different sizes of all the trees that we see in this web scene. I'm just going to apply my changes and save my web scene. Now that it's been saved, I can open it up in a 3D template or an app in Web App Builder. And that's because we're all using a shared spec. So on the developer site, you can check out our web scene spec, just like we released with the webmap spec last year. Thank you, Jeremy.
Thanks, Russ. That's awesome to see that smart mapping is finally starting to come to 3D in both online and in 10.5 Enterprise. And also, it's exciting to see how easy it is to publish your feature layers as these 3D visualization scene layers. OK, to show us what's coming in 3D in the JavaScript API, I'll turn it over to Joe.
Thanks, Jeremy. So the web scene that Russ just saved to online can be loaded into the JavaScript API with just these few lines of code. All I need to do is create a new web scene object and pass it that portal item ID and attach a new scene view to it. And then it'll automatically load all of the layers, including the layer customization and styling, and any other of the settings that may be in the web scene, for example, the initial view. I can now go ahead and change that scene, modify the scene from within the API. So let's assume that I found a data set that maps all of the locations of trash bins in New York. I'm using this layer factory method that Jan has already introduced. Again, just pass it the portal item ID of the layer and add the resulting layer to the scene. So this shows the layer with its default symbology, but perhaps these little dots is not how I want my trash bins to look like. The web styles that Russ has used in the scene viewer are also available from within the API. And in fact, they're available on the entire platform. We've created a guide page that lists all of the available options, along with handy snippets that you can just paste into your code to use those symbols. I've already done that here, and I'm going to, in addition, customize the symbol by first downloading it and then setting its height and its color to get this thematic visualization of gigantic blue trash cans in New York. And then finally, I can save my changes that I've made to the scene back to online, again, with just a few lines of code, and share the resulting scenes and open it up in any of the other apps that support web scenes, like the Web App Builder or ArcGIS Pro. For 3D object scene layers, we've added capability to filter and query features. And together with the existing functionality for data-driven visualization and for user interaction, we now have the tools to make really powerful and compelling 3D city applications. This prototype here is based on data that we got from the Dubai Design District. On the right-hand side, you can see some statistics, and these are computed using the query capabilities, and they automatically update when I select different buildings. I can color the units by floor area or by usage type. I can make interactive charts, or I can apply filters, for example, to the floor level, and you can see that the charts and the statistics automatically update to the current selection. Among the many other features that we've added to the JavaScript API, I would like to highlight the point cloud layer. This scene here shows a last data set of New York that consists of several billion points. Thanks to a new format in the scene layer, we can stream this kind of data efficiently to web clients. You can also style these point cloud layers in the JavaScript API, similarly as you would style a feature layer. Let's assume that we're interested in keeping the vegetation under control in the Central Park. This snippet here assigns a renderer that draws all of the points above 50 meters in red and all of the ones between 40 and 50 meters in yellow. And here's a sample for an interactive application. When the user clicks on a point, we can obtain the coordinates of that point, and we can feed it into our new elevation query API. The result of that query operation is the height of the terrain dataset underneath that location. And so from the two different elevation values that we get, we can compute the clearance beneath the bridge and annotate it in the scene. Now, if there's a specific type of visualization that you need, but that's not available in the JavaScript API yet, there's always the possibility for implementing it directly in WebGL using our external renderer interface. This beautiful demo application made by Jesse downloads vector field data from image servers and then simulates and renders 1 million particles on the GPU in real time. And that's all I have for you right now. Back to Jeremy.
Thanks, Joe. It's great to see what you can do today with 3D in the web APIs. It's pretty amazing. And then also, this last demo shows what you can do if you want to get down into the WebGL yourself by hooking into the external renderer. OK, now to talk about runtime in 3D, I'd like to turn it over to Adrian.
Thank you, Jeremy. You're probably familiar with the 3D capabilities of the ArcGIS Runtime SDKs, especially if you've been using applications like ArcGIS Earth, Drone2Map, or your own native 3D applications. But for a lot of you, 3D on mobile platform is important. So I'm happy to announce that with our next release, all the runtime SDKs are going to share the same 3D capabilities, which means you can write 3D applications for Windows, macOS, Linux, but also for Android, iOS, and Windows Phone. I've here opened in Android Studio the scene that Joe and Russ already showed you of New York. So you can see that I have street map base layer, I have some elevation data, and then I have the building of New York as a scene layer. Those are all public services provided by Esri. Let's comment all that code and replace it by one single layer created by one of our partners. While it's compiling, let me quickly explain how we can share our scene layers, not only part of the ArcGIS platform, but with the entire 3D industry. It's because they build on top of an open standard called Index 3D Scene Layers, or I3S. You can find here on the developer website all the information that you need to create your own 3D scene layers, especially a link to our public GitHub repo, Esri/iSuite spec. As I was saying, one of our partners, Vricon, is already producing its own 3D thin layers of a specific type called integrated mesh. Integrated mesh is like taking your elevation that can come from terrain, buildings, vegetation, and merge it with your imagery to create one single thin layer. And it is the thin layer I have running here right now on my Android phone. As it's actually a package, I can actually take my phone offline. And now you can see me going through that amazing data of Yosemite National Park locally on my Android phone. One of the good things of having 3D on your mobile device is that you can take it with you in the field. So, for example, maybe you want to digitize some bears that have been seen in the Yosemite Valley. And maybe also a mountain lion on the other side. Of course, I can also take advantage of the sensor on my device to control, to look at the view exactly like if I will look at it if I was actually in Yosemite. So if I look up, I will see that people will take whatever it takes to actually get out of a couple of bears, even if it means climbing Half Dome. Oh, hey, Yuan. I'm going to show you quickly how it's done to control the camera in that kind of virtual reality experience. It's as easy as getting the data from your sensor, maybe do some recalculation depending on the data you get from your particular device, and just set it to the camera. That was it for 3D in the runtime.